Hi everyone, good morning. My name is Mary Rubenis and we're here this morning to learn a little bit more about Attainable, which is the Massachusetts Able Savings Plan. Give me, if you can, in the chat, just let me know if you can hear me okay. Just, you know, say yes, I can hear you. That would be great. Basically, today is just really an overview of Able and about Attainable, and just to give you some insights as to the basics of the accounts and how they work and how you're eligible for them. I'll go through just some housekeeping here, just so you know where to find things and how to participate. You'll all be muted. If you do have any questions, you can type them in the question box. I will do that at the end. There's also some handouts, the slides, as well as a brochure. You can take those, you can grab those if you would like. And I guess we'll just get started. So I'm just gonna move this over here. So I usually just like to share a little bit about MEFA and just give you some background about who we are and what we do. So we are a nonprofit state authority created in 1982. And really our mission is to help families plan, save, and pay for college. We do that through a variety of ways. We have some tax advantage savings plans. Attainable is one of those. We also are the state sponsor for the Massachusetts 529 College Savings Plan. And we also do private loans as well. And then one of the big things, especially this time of year that we're doing, is we just give a lot of free webinars around the whole process of, you know, applying, planning, you know, college applications, that type of thing, financial aid. So we give a lot of free webinars currently around just the whole process of that. So feel free to check that out on the website to see what else that we do that you might be interested or know someone that might be interested. And so I usually like to share with folks how the partnership came about between MEFA and Fidelity. So MEFA is the state sponsor for Attainable, which is the Massachusetts Able Savings Plan, and Fidelity is the program manager. And what that means is Fidelity manages these accounts for us. And so if you're going to open one of these accounts, you're going to do it through Fidelity. The Attainable plan was launched in 2017. That's when Massachusetts rolled out their Able accounts. And like I mentioned, we're the state sponsor, Fidelity is the program manager. And how this partnership came about, back in 1999, MEFA selected Fidelity to also administer the Massachusetts 529, which I mentioned earlier, which is the college savings plan. And again, we selected them for their obvious expertise in money management, and it's been a really great partnership. So they manage the U Fund, which is the Mass 529, and they also manage Attainable, which is the Able plan, and that is a 529A. It's in the same tax code as the regular 529. And so just some background on Able and how it came about. So the Able Act was federally legislated back in 2014, and it stands for Achieving a Better Life Experience. And so what this legislation did was it established these Able accounts, which are tax exempt accounts, meaning when you go to withdraw funds from these accounts, you're not gonna pay taxes on it. And you have to be an eligible qualified individual. We'll talk about what that is with a disability to qualify for one of these. And you also need to use it for qualified disability expenses. And these accounts allow someone who might be receiving federal benefits like SSI or Medicaid, it allows them to save over $2,000 without it affecting those means-tested benefits. So that was really the real push for these accounts to come about, because currently, unless you have an ABLE account or a special needs trust, you can't save over that $2,000 asset cap. So very significant for these to come about. And I'll just share, when ABLE was passed, it was one of the most significant pieces of disability legislation since the ADA was passed 30 years ago. So it was really, really significant for this to come about. It took almost a decade for the legislation to get passed, and 85% of Congress supported the ABLE Act. So really a wonderful thing for this to happen. So eligibility, how do you become eligible for Attainable or for an ABLE account? The disability has to have occurred prior to the age of 26, And then if you're receiving SSI or SSDI and meet the age requirement, you're automatically eligible to open one of these accounts. Even if you aren't receiving benefits though, and you meet the age requirement, as long as Social Security has a list of what they consider to be a disability, essentially, they call it compassionate allowances. As long as you're meeting one of those, you're going to qualify to open one of these and you meet the age requirement. Essentially, you're self-certifying that you meet the diagnosis. So for Attainable, for our program, when you go to open this, the documentation, you don't need it to open the account. You open the account online. We just tell people you should have it. You know, it's always good to have documentation from a physician saying, yes, indeed, you have whatever disability type. Just to have that, so in case you need it at some point. But essentially, it's any type of physical, mental health diagnosis, intellectual, developmental disability, and you'll qualify to open one of these. And so some of the qualified expenses for Attainable or Enable account, you can use it for healthcare, so healthcare appointments or prescriptions. You can use it for housing. You can use it to pay your rent, pay your mortgage. You can also use these for education. So if somebody was going to college, they needed obviously books, supplies, tuition, room and board. You can use it for all of that. Transportation, you're going to buy a car. Uber or Lyft, those type of expenses are also qualified. Assistive technology, you need an iPad to communicate. Employment training, personal support services like a PCA or some type of support service. And then just really basic living needs. So clothing, food, those type of things. These are all qualifying expenses. But I tell people, this list isn't exhaustive. There's definitely some things that fall outside this that are certainly qualified. As long as it relates to your disability, you can use your ABLE account for that. A good example of that might be somebody who needs to send their son or daughter to a therapeutic camp. Would that be covered by an ABLE account if they had one? Absolutely. So that's something that's not in this list, but that certainly would be covered. And so some of the benefits of an ABLE account, I mentioned this earlier, the asset cap, it allows the account owner or beneficiary, that person with the disability, they're the account owner and beneficiary on an ABLE account, it allows them to save over $2,000 without it affecting those federal benefits. The other nice thing about ABLE is it permits the account to be owned by that individual with the disability. And it's also providing financial independence and really multiple tax benefits. I'll share what some of those are. Like I mentioned earlier, there's no taxes when you're withdrawing, you're not paying taxes on it as long as you're using it for a qualified expense. And it offers a new way to invest. You're investing in the market and there's portfolios. And I'll show you what that looks like in another screenshot. And so for Attainable, and this is the same across the board nationwide in terms of how much you can put in into an ABLE account for a calendar year, it's $15,000. That's the cap that you can put into an ABLE account currently for 2020. If you are getting SSI, that is protected up to $100,000, meaning you can save up to $100,000 in an ABLE account without it impacting your SSI. If you go over, they'll just suspend the benefit until you drop back under. And then the max that you can save in an ABLE account in a calendar year, this is for Attainable, is $400,000. And so a couple of tax updates I usually like to share with people, and then one just about the FAFSA because it relates to what we do at MEFA. The first one is this ABLE Financial Planning Act. And what this essentially allows someone to do, many times we get questions about somebody might have started a regular 529 college savings for a family member and realized they're not going to go to college. And with that particular account, you have to use it for college related expenses or else you will be taxed on it. You get penalized if you do not. So this legislation now allows someone who has a 529 to roll it over into an ABLE account without incurring any tax or penalty up to the $15K in a calendar year. So we see this frequently where someone might have overfunded a 529, or a grandparent might have contributed to a 529 now to realize the child's not going to go to school. So a really nice feature now is that you can roll over these 529s into an ABLE account. The beneficiary has to be the same individual on both accounts or a family member of the other. So you could take a sibling's 529 and roll it into, say, a sibling's ABLE account. And then the other one that's really great for people that are working, it's called ABLE to Work Act. And this legislation allows an ABLE account beneficiary who's working to actually contribute over that annual limit of 15K into their ABLE account. The amount that they can contribute currently, it's about $12,490. And so potentially they could contribute up to $27,490 into their ABLE account tax advantage. So again, it comes with a few limitations. One is that you can't be participating in the employer's retirement plan and also take advantage of this additional contribution. But it's a great benefit to be able to take advantage of. You can, you know, contribute over that 15K if you're the account owner and if you're working. And then the one that relates to really what we do in terms of college planning at MEFA is the FAFSA. So the FAFSA is the Federal Application for Federal Student Aid. So everyone fills this out if you're applying for financial aid when you're going to college. Every school requires it. And so they came out with guidance on the fact that if you do have an ABLE account, you don't have to list it. The funds, I should say, in the ABLE account aren't counted as an asset and included in determining your financial aid eligibility. So they specifically exclude that. The FAFSA doesn't account the funds in an ABLE account, so that's really fantastic. Some resources that I usually like to share that I highly recommend if you're really just starting to learn about ABLE. The first one is the ABLE National Resource Center, and it's ablenrc.org. It's a great resource. It's run by the National Disability Institute. They actually compare all the state plans. You can go there and sign up for webinars. There's just a lot of information there around ABLE, so I encourage you to really go there to learn more. Obviously, the MEFA site, MEFA.org, we actually have a dedicated page for Attainable. And we also list a lot of local resources there, things related to benefits counseling. We've tried to list out, you know, Mass Rehab Commission, Work Without Limits. They split the state. There are two organizations that split the state in terms of benefits counseling. So, you know, we list some things like that there. So I encourage you to go there to learn more. And also you can sign up for email updates there. There's a registration form for that. You know, you'll get updates if we post blog content related to disabilities, if, you know, we have upcoming webinars that you want to stay on top of, or just additional information and updates to ABLE. It's a great way to just keep up to date on that. And then lastly, you would go to fidelity.com/ABLE to sign up and open one of these accounts online. So this is the link for that, the landing page where you would go to do that. And then I always like to share the Social Security actually has a fair amount of information on their site related to ABLE. The one thing, if you want to just get into the weeds a little bit more about how it intersects with Social Security, they have something called this Program Operations Manual System, or POMS. And there's a specific section, as you can see here, that's dedicated to ABLE. So I encourage you to go there as well. Just again, to see, you know, they actually break down qualified expenses and they just get into, you know, a little more detail around ABLE and SSA. So it's a great resource and just be familiar with and know about it. The other one is the National Disability Institute, which I mentioned, who manages ABLE National Resource. They launched during COVID this great financial resilience center, and it was designed to really help people manage their finances and offer some virtual financial counseling and coaching if needed. And so you have access to online financial wellness training, and it's all free of charge. So I've been really mentioning it in my webinars just because it's a great free resource. And here's the link at the bottom, nationaldisabilityinstitute.org /financial-resilience-center/. But if you go to the NDI, National Disability Institute site, you would be able to, you know, probably find a link there as well. But this is just a great resource that popped up during COVID, so I've been trying to share it. And then lastly, this is my contact info, my email, mroganis@mefa.org. And then these are all the channels that we're on social, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and YouTube. We post content daily and weekly, and we post usually twice a week something related to attainable and disability related content, or we promote webinars that we'll be doing. So I encourage you to follow us there as well, in case you know, you just want to, you know, do an additional webinar or stay up to date. And so that's my last slide. I'm just going to take a peek and see if anyone has asked any questions. So I don't see anything. So feel free, if you have any questions or you would like to, you know, just follow up on something that I mentioned in one of the slides, feel free to wait a few minutes to see if any questions pop up. Okay, well, I don't see anything. So again, feel free to always reach out. I'm happy to answer any questions, or if you have, you know, individuals that you might be working with who are looking to open an account and they have questions, feel free to reach out. Again, my email is mrubanis@mefa.org. I'm just going to redock this so you can't see it. Oh, sorry, I didn't see your hand. Okay, so someone asked, is it $15K per year to transfer from 529? Yes, it is. So if you have a 529 and you want to roll it over into ABLE, you can roll over up to $15K in a calendar year. That's correct. I was told when I signed up in 2017, I could only roll up to $15K in total. No, you can roll over in a year, in a calendar year, you can roll over $15K from your 529 into ABLE. So yes, that is good news. I'll wait a few more minutes to see if there's any other questions. I encourage you definitely go to ABLE National Resource and the MEFA site, like I mentioned earlier, just to you know, learn more information about ABLE. And if you're on social, follow them as well, because they post a lot of content. How does someone withdraw funds from an ABLE account? So that's a great question. So essentially how it works is you open the ABLE account, and then when you're going to pay your bills, you're going to move the funds from the ABLE account to, say, your personal checking account, and then pay your bills. And then just keep in mind, people sometimes might not realize, is once the funds leave ABLE, they're not considered protected anymore, meaning you don't want to be moving you know, large sums of money, say, into the checking account, because then that would obviously accumulate over that $2,000 asset cap. So just bear that in mind. But essentially, that's how it works. I can also share, Fidelity has some great free online digital tools that they offer. And one of them, and it allows you to sort of keep track of how you're spending the account, which is great. So one of them is this cash management account, which you can link to your attainable account when you open it. And that's just a free checking account, and it comes with a free debit card. So you only get that if you open the cash management account. And then once you do link it to the cash management account, it also allows you to take advantage of something that they call Full View, which allows you to track and categorize your expenses for your ABLE account. So yeah, those are just, that's essentially how it works. You move the money from the ABLE account into a checking account, or whatever account you're gonna move it to, and then pay your bills. What happens if someone passes away? I'm gonna just pull this down. What happens if someone passes away? Does it go to a beneficiary? So if someone passes away, if the account owner or beneficiary passes away, it goes to the person's estate. But prior to that happening, you can pay funeral expenses or burial expenses.
from the ABLE account or any outstanding disability related expenses prior to it going to the estate. If the person received Medicaid, if they had had an account and then obviously passed away, there is something called the Medicaid clawback in Massachusetts. It only applies from the time of the ABLE account being opened until their passing. And they say there's a potential that the state could claw back some Medicaid that was paid out to that individual minus any premiums that they might have paid. Like I said, it only applies to from the time the account was opened until their passing. So if they had been receiving Medicaid for 20 years, say prior to 2020, say, from 2000 to 2020, they had been receiving Medicaid, but they opened the ABLE account this year and then passed away, say 5 years from now, it would only apply from 2020 to 2025. But there is a clawback, I just tell people to be aware of that, it does exist. Somebody is asking, I work for an agency that holds rep payees for some clients. We would like to set up an ABLE account so he can have more than 2K and is checking, is there a minimum amount required to open an ABLE account? So no, there is no minimum for Attainable to open. You can open it with whatever you would like. I'm just waiting to see if anything else comes in. So a follow-up question, would the rep payee then be managing the ABLE account because he cannot do that? So no. So in order to be, in order to manage the account for someone, so essentially the ABLE account owner or beneficiary manages the account themselves. If they can't do that, when you set up the account, you can set it up with what's called a person with signature authority or a PSA. And so that individual would manage the account for the account owner. The PSA has to be a parent, a guardian, or a power of attorney in order to be a PSA in the account. And then that individual would manage it for the account owner. And like I said, when the account is set up, you would set it up that way. I had set up an ABLE account for my daughter who qualifies. And so when I set it up, I'm the PSA in the account, I'm a parent. And so I can manage it for her. And I'll also just share, there's an 800 number that you can call to, get additional questions answered. I'm actually gonna type it in the box here that Fidelity has that's dedicated to Attainable. You can call to get additional questions answered. They'll also stay on the line with you if you are opening an account and you have questions and you just want to make sure you're opening the account right. I just put it in the chat box. That's the 800 number that you would call, and they would stay on the line with you while you're online trying to open the account. And then if you had any questions, they could help. The reps are trained to answer any questions that you might have. But I thought I would share that with you. All right. Well, I don't see any more questions. I'll just wait another minute or so and see if anyone else has any questions. And like I mentioned, you can grab, there's a brochure and also the slides, a PDF of the slides you can grab. I will also, we recorded this, so I will send you the recording and also a PDF of the slides once the webinar is complete, later in the day. All right, well, I don't see any more questions. So I guess I will say thank you for joining. And like I said, if you have any other questions, feel free to reach out. My email, mrubenis@mefa.org.
And or like I mentioned, the 800 number at Fidelity is a great resource to get questions answered as well. All right, well, thanks for joining, and have a good day. Take care. Bye.